very warm welcome to everyone to our seventh Sankofa lecture commemorating Black History Month. And I'm Sister Barbara Reed. I'm the Vice President and Academic Dean here at CTU and also Professor of New Testament Studies. I'm very, very pleased to be able to welcome you this afternoon along with Father Senior and Brian Murphy, Vice President for External Relations, Father Senior, our President, and especially all of our Tolton scholars here present, our Tolton grads and friends and students here at CTU. We're very, very pleased to have you here for this event. This month of November was designated in 1990 as National Black Catholic, as the Black Catholic History Month, was so designated by the National Black Catholic Clergy Caucus of the U.S. because there are two commemorative dates that fall within this month: St. Augustine's birthday, which is November 13th, and St. Martin de Porres on November 3rd. So as a Dominican, I have to smile and with great pride at San Martin de Porres. But more importantly, as the website from the National Black Catholic Caucus Congress states, November not only marks the time when we pray for all saints and souls in loving remembrance, but also a time to recall the saints and souls of Africa and the African diaspora. And so since 2004, we have been marking this month with our Sankofa lecture, and this is our seventh. So to introduce our distinguished speaker this year, Bishop Perry is our director of the Augustus Tolton Scholarship Program. Dr. C. Vanessa White, who also is professor of spirituality here at CTU. So welcome to Vanessa, who will introduce Bishop Perry.
As Barbara mentioned, this evening I welcome you to our seventh annual Sankofa event. Now, some people may be wondering what does Sankofa mean. Sankofa is from the Akan language of Ghana, West Africa, and means one must return to the past in order to move forward. And in one way is symbolized by this symbol here, Sankofa. As you note, the bird is reaching back as it's moving forward. So thinking about our history, we must not forget our history as we move forward. 2010 also marked the year when the Archdiocese of Chicago officially brought forth the cause for canonization of Father Augustus Tolton. And we are proud to have for our seventh annual event, the Most Reverend Joseph N. Perry. Bishop Joseph Perry was appointed within the pontificate of His Holiness Pope John II, titular Bishop of Lead, a historic former see in South Dakota, and auxiliary to His Eminence Father Francis Cardinal George, Archbishop of Chicago, on May 5, 1998. His episcopal consecration took place on June 29, 1998, the feast of Saints Peter and Paul at Chicago's Holy Name Cathedral. And I was there. His duties currently see him as Episcopal Vicar for one of six vicariates of the Archdiocese of Chicago, a jurisdiction that covers currently 70 parishes and two missions and an oratory. Bishop Perry, originally a priest of the Archdiocese of Milwaukee, was ordained a priest by the late Archbishop William Edward Cousins on May 24, 1975 at St. John Cathedral, Milwaukee. After an 18-month assignment as associate pastor at St. Nicholas Parish, Milwaukee, he was assigned to the tribunal offices of the Archdiocese in December 1976 and was sent for graduate studies in canon law at the Catholic University of America, Washington, D.C. His priestly ministry has been spent with ecclesiastical law and education, working primarily in the church courts as advocate, then as judge in the Court of Appeals that services the Diocese of Superior, La Crosse, Green Bay, and Madison, and as a conciliation and arbitration clerk. In 1983, he was appointed judicial vicar for the Archdiocese of Milwaukee, a post he held for 2 6-year terms until his appointment of pastor of All Saints Parish, Milwaukee, in June 1995. He served as the chaplain of the St. Thomas More Lawyer Society of Wisconsin, an association of Catholic lawyers and judges. Until his appointment, he was also adjunct professor of canon law studies at Marquette University Law School in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and Sacred Heart Seminary, Hales Corners, Wisconsin. As satellites to his duties as auxiliary bishop, he functions as adjunct professor of canon law at St. Mary of the Lake Seminary, Mundelein, Illinois, and associate judge in the Second Instance Court of Appeals for the diocese configured to the province of Chicago. And a little side note, he was also professor one summer at our Summer Institute in canon law. And I actually took your class. I should be. This excellent, excellent professor. Bishop Perry is national chaplain for the Knights of St. Peter Clover and Ladies Auxiliary, and also vice president of the board for the National Black Catholic Congress, Baltimore, Maryland. On January 28, 2010, Cardinal Francis George appointed Bishop Perry postulator for the diocesan phase of the cause for sanctity of Father Augustus Tolton, first priest of African descent in the United States, who labored in the Diocese of Alton, now Springfield, Illinois, and the Archdiocese of Chicago. Bishop Perry's lecture is entitled The Road to Sainthood, Father Augustus Tolton. I present to you Bishop Joseph N. Perry.
Friends and guests, good evening.
Good evening.
Carlos, you're smiling. This is a great time for the Archdiocese of Chicago. A diocese like this, things are always happening. And the Cardinal certainly surprised me. In fact, he didn't even talk to me. I just got this decree in the mail. And I was diocesan postulator, so said my obedient yes, and then went over to Rome, talked to the authorities there to present the story of Tolton to the prefect of the Congregation for the Causes of the Saints and other individuals. And 2 weeks ago, we were visited by two Vatican officials who met with me and the Cardinal to discuss next steps. Already, there are reports of favors being received at Tolton's intercession. There's been several of them that have come in so far. And two rather remarkable stories. One about a man in Texas who had a mass on a lung that was supposed to be removed. And just before he had a last set of x-rays taken before he went into surgery, there was no mass. And then just yesterday, I received a letter from a woman in New Jersey who had a 41-year-old daughter with a 96% blockage in her aortic artery. And that disappears. In both of these instances, the parties owe the sudden turnaround to their prayer to God through Tolton's intercession. So we'll see what happens with these. These have to be... Tonight, I will send to Rome this latest report to see what they tell me about it. Take some necessary instructions there from to see what has to be done there. That is indeed good news.
Yes.
Chicago, you know, we're famous for Al Capone and John Dillinger and Frank Lloyd, many other famous people on the other side of life. But Chicago had two other saints who walked our streets. They were consecrated women. I'm not sure you know, or you didn't know them, but you know of them. Francis Cabrini, apostle to the Italian immigrants. And her chapel, or prayer in the room where she died, and it's still preserved. We go and visit and pray. Many pilgrims go there today. And then Catherine Drexel, of course, who was seen any number of times walking our streets, visiting her sisters here at St. Elizabeth's and St. Monica's. Drexel Boulevard on the south side is named after her uncle, who was a banker. It was a banker family, and there were Drexel banks here until, I think, about the mid-1930s. Her great uncle assisted in the rebuilding of Chicago after the Great Fire of 1871. So Chicago is no stranger to saints. Catherine Drexel came in and out of St. Elizabeth Parish School there on 43rd in Michigan to check on her sisters. Talked there. And she carried on correspondence with Father Augustus Tolton and is reported to have given him $36,000 for the building of St. Monica Church. I'm not sure what value $36,000 would be today. Maybe about 10 times as much today. But Tolton did not write very, very much, but the letters that he wrote her were somehow preserved by the Blessed Sacrament Sisters. And delving into those archives allows us to get a deeper glimpse into the person of Augustus Tolton. African-American Catholics, of course, are accustomed to hearing mentions of St. Mark of the Corps. It's the only saint we knew of for the longest time. And most recently, Josephine Baquita, who was canonized as saint in 2000, by Pope John Paul II, along with Catherine Drexel. She's the saint of the Sudet, a former slave who was drugged naked all over the world until a group of nuns rescued her, and she became one of them, and is now proclaimed a saint. Some of us heard of the 22 young martyrs of Uganda, East Africa, in 1886, men who were brutally massacred for their faith, the king of the Baganda tribe, Mwanga. And we know of parishes named after St. Benedict the Black, who's also known as St. Benedict the Moor or St. Benedict the African. But that is about it as far as Black saints are known in our community. We would like to add another one in the name of Augustus Tolton. As Vanessa referenced, it was last year that the cardinal, during the year for the priest, referenced Augustus Tolton as a model for priesthood. And bringing up his name came up practically spontaneously. As a man in our memory, a true and dedicated priest who worked here and whose memory looms large across the country. As a historical figure, but a lot of people didn't know much about him. The cardinal would like to pursue this and see what we can do with it. There are any number of entities across the country that carry his name, ministerial and educational ventures. Just recently in Columbia, Missouri, which is in the Diocese of Jefferson City, is building a new high school. And it's going to be named after Tolton. Brush Creek is northeast section of the state of Missouri, where the farm or the plantation where the Tolton's labored is located. Tolton was born into slavery in 1854, April 1st, along with his sister, his younger sister Anne, and an older brother Charles. He was brought to southern Illinois as a little boy by his mother after a harrowing escape across some 40 miles that included a night journey in a dilapidated rowboat across the Mississippi River. Words cannot describe how threatening was this escape for Martha Jane and her children. How she must have thought and planned it for some great length of time, and the escape had no choice but to be a success. For if she was caught, most certainly her children would have been snatched away from her, and she would have been brutally punished. When you study the slave narratives of escaped and recaptured slaves, they are some of the most gut-wrenching narratives to be read in the name of human torture and even murder. So she had no choice. no other choice but to succeed in grabbing freedom. Peter Tolton, the father, had already left to fight in the Civil War with Union forces, but he never returned. Somehow he became ill with dysentery and died in a hospital in St. Louis, Missouri. Now, Martha Jane would not find this out for several years thereafter, finding his name on a list of casualties. Mrs. Tolton and her son Augustus worked several different labor jobs in support of their family once they arrived in Quincy, a station of the Underground Railroad. They worked in a tobacco factory, a bottling and beverage factory. Augustus attended several schools in between work shifts. He was thrown out of a Catholic school, St. Boniface, due to protests and threats delivered by white parishioners. He was later picked up by the sympathetic pastor of St. Peter Parish in Quincy, Father Peter McGeer, and enrolled in their parish school. The parish still exists and names its parish hall after Father Tolton, the huge marble likeness of Tolton in front of the parish school there. From the time that Augustus made his first Holy Communion and confirmation at St. Peter Parish there, he began to speak about becoming a priest. But the obstacles seemed insurmountable. Slaves and former slaves were allowed only haphazard participation in American life in the 19th century, and there were no laws that would guarantee their movement in society, let alone protect them. Much of this apartheid was co-opted by the various churches, Catholic and Protestants. Blacks lived a precarious existence at the whim of white America in those days. The Franciscans accepted Augustus into Quincy College after tutoring him in the classical languages of Latin and Greek and the liberal arts. They offered him a scholarship. He studied philosophy as well. No seminary in the United States would take a black student. This was apparent after several years of writing an inquiry. He finally was accepted at the College of the Propaganda Fide in Rome at the arrangement of the Franciscan Fathers of the Sacred Heart Province, the same province which once served Corpus Christi and Hills Franciscan High School and continues to serve St. Peter's in Rome. Under then the racial climate, it was considered that Tolton would prepare for the priesthood to be sent to Africa. In fact, while he studied in the propaganda, he studied Congolese dialects because he thought he would be sent to Congo. The cardinal prefect, Giovanni Simeone, instead told Tolton the day before he was ordained that he was overturning the vote of his superiors, telling him that he should return to the United States, because the Church in the United States owed it to itself to have a priest of African descent. If they in fact consider themselves to be the most enlightened of nations, why should they not accept a black priest? Tolton, although quite surprised at the news of his appointment, followed the cardinal's advice and proceeded upon his oath as a propaganda priest and returned to Quincy, Illinois, which at that time was the Diocese of Alton and Illinois. He was ordained April 24th, 1886. Augustus was accepted back in his hometown in part, but he suffered greatly because of the opposition that he experienced in Quincy by both Protestant as well as Catholic clergy. Protestant clergymen threatened their people not to go anywhere near St. Joseph's Church or the parish school. Then there was one particular German priest who happened to be a dean in the area who thought Tolton should restrict himself to ministering to blacks alone. As it was, white Catholics were inspired by Tolton, who came to his masses and other ministrations and contributed financially to the poor parish, to the jealous reaction of this particular priest and others. Priest took his objections to the bishop a number of times and got the bishop's ear. As opposition mounted towards Tolton, it became apparent that he would be asked to leave Quincy, where he had just started a credible ministry to the Negro community. Black Catholics were used to the gift of their own priests who looked like them. In the midst of the furor, Tolton was invited to leave town by the bishop as well as the dean. At the same time, he was invited to come to Chicago by Archbishop Patrick Fian to work among African Americans here, but Tolton hesitated giving an answer to the archbishop until the situation in Quincy became intolerable. And with permission of his superiors in Rome, Tolton finally accepted Fian's invitation to come to Chicago, which he did the week before Christmas of 1889. Taking a fledgling congregation of Negro Catholics titled the St. Augustine Society that gathered in the basement of St. Mary's Church, which in those days was at 9th and Wabash, today it's called Old St. Mary's, pastored by the Claretian Fathers. Father Tolton became the founding pastor of the new Negro apostolate, which merged into a new parish, which he titled St. Monica, at 36th and Dearborn Street. But Tolton's health began to show signs of exhaustion and emotional distress only after a few years of ministry. Following 8 years of pastoral labor here in this city, he died at the age of 43 of complications associated with heat stroke and uremia. This was caused by an exceptional heat wave that hit the city the first week of July of 1897. Sustained temperatures at 105 degrees Fahrenheit really gripped the city. There were about 60-some people who died in Chicago that week, including two priests, Tolton and another. In those days, there was no air conditioning, other kinds of aeration, so forth. There is no information contained in the archival records before us that speaks of Father Augustus's health. Negroes seldom had access to adequate health care beyond old-fashioned kitchen remedies. Few, if any, reputable hospitals would take Negroes as patients where whites were served. His parishioners, however, were aware that Father was wearing himself out by hard work, including the mental stress connected with fundraising for the support of his parish and maneuvering the choppy waters of racial acceptance. At times, he had to ask the mass server to bring him a chair because he could not stand to deliver his sermon. Tolton was a well-educated man and proved a wise priest, whose priesthood was hampered by isolation, self-doubt, and economic hardship. His letters to Mother Catherine Drexel are extant, that betray much of his pathos in a socially intolerant era. He was completely dedicated to the people, and he faithfully visited the sick and came to the rescue of the desperate poor on Chicago's south side. In the 19th century, before antibiotics were available, priests often died in their 50s, if not before, because they were so often exposed to people with a variety of communicable diseases. And we have no information that Tolton never saw a doctor. Getting off the train in Chicago at the 35th Street station, returning from a priest's retreat in Bourbonnais, Illinois, he collapsed on the street on 35th and Ellis Avenue on the way to his rectory. Police rushed him to Mercy Hospital, and they worked on him for about 4 hours, and then he succumbed. He is buried by his specific request in Quincy, Illinois, at St. Peter's Cemetery. Tolton was a man beset on all sides by racism and its tragic consequences. A Roman collar around the neck of a black man was an anomaly in the white community, a new sensation in the black community. Yet Tolton dared to believe that no door can be kept closed against the movement of the Lord and the power of the Spirit. He preached that the Catholic Church was the chief means for the advancement of the circumstances of the black man. And his loyalty to the church as a Catholic priest was undaunted. His sanctity arises from his perseverance, his long suffering, his dutifulness in the face of insurmountable odds, his cheerfulness, his pastoral zeal, his abiding love for the church and an unfailing sense of obedience. He bore the burden of being the first and the only one. Following his death, Archbishop Fian changed the status of St. Monica to a mission served by the priest of St. Elizabeth. Later on, St. Monica was given its own diocesan pastor by the name of Father John Morris, who pastored them for 15 years. And during his pastorate, they erected a school for Negro children. In 1912, Mother Catherine Drexel sent five of her sisters to take charge of the school. And with time, the school eventually emerged with St. Elizabeth's Parish, and more Sisters of the Blessed Sacrament were sent to teach. 1917, Cardinal Mundelein requested the Society of the Divine Word missionary fathers to come take over the Negro apostolate in Chicago. St. Monica, the first Black Catholic parish of Chicago, served the community on the South Side until 1924. Church building itself remained unfinished and was finally raised in 1945 to make room for the housing project that's there on the park. So over the years, groups of Black Catholic clergy and laity have made pilgrimages to his grave and the sites of his early priesthood there in Quincy. There have been punctuations of key dates in his life, such as the centennial of his death, which was celebrated in 1997, where bishops and people gathered to recall in memory of so noble a priest. He is revered as the first Black Catholic priest serving in the United States, whose ministry was in the Black community. From the earliest days of Christ's Church, Christians, by popular acclaim, have raised up models of holiness in order to be strengthened and inspired by those who preceded them. Many of those so honored shed their blood for Christ in the Church. This spontaneous act on part of the Christian community is probably the earliest known concept of canonization, the popularization of the individual. I think it's important to realize that saints are not made by the Pope, not made by the hierarchy of the Church. Saints are made by the people. And the process, even in these modern days, the process looks for the grassroots acclaim of the people. Otherwise, a saint is never made. Saints are men and women who were members of the Church, lived and died in and for the Church. Church possesses the marks of holiness which she received from Jesus, her founder. And according to God's plan, the Church is the source of grace and holiness through the sacraments and the word of Scripture. In this sense, the Church gives to individual Christians what they need in order to live lives that reflect the holiness of God, with the cooperation of the will of the individual is necessary. Raising up a person to the honors of the altar means that the Church is making the fact of a holy life public with the aid of the Holy Spirit. An early stage of this process takes place in the local diocese, where the life, the reputations, and the virtues of the person who is proposed is researched. That's the stage within which we are now. To explore a cause for Father Augustus Tolton, we need to spread the word around about his life, as well as determine if there is sufficient devotion on the part of the faithful to make this a successful cause. Whether anyone prays to him or has received favors from God through Tolton's heavenly intercession. We're now examining archival material from about 8 different sources where he served, his writings and other articles and testimonies. Cardinal George has established an historical commission to study the facts of Tolton's life, and I'm already speaking to groups around the country about his life. In the meantime, it's important that our parishes pray that Tolton might be so honored as a servant of God, and as venerable, and as blessed, and finally as a saint, and the required miracle cures to endorse the latter two assignations of signs from heaven. Clearly, Tolton must be more for us than just an historical figure, like Frederick Douglass or Harriet Tubman or Martin Luther King. There has to be demonstrated that there is a conversation going on between heaven and earth with respect to Tolton. It has as its stamp of approval a miraculous and unexplainable turnaround in health that science cannot describe. Father Tolton worked valiantly in Quincy and in Chicago, and through it all, he remained a faithful and dutiful priest and Catholic. He did not leave the church. He stuck with the church. His quiet witness is a challenge to our prejudices and narrow-mindedness that keeps us insulated from the variety that is the kingdom of God. He's also a patron saint of reconciliation, patron saint of perseverance. Cardinal Jurat said that we need Tolton's prayers and his help, especially to become a more united church. Secondly, his example of priestly dedication, his learning and preaching are great examples for our seminarians and priests and should inspire the laity as well. Cardinal Justin Regali of Philadelphia, the home of Catherine Drexel, says that, I quote, Tolton carried a cross in his life in the difficult circumstances in which he was placed. His fidelity poses a marvelous example to all of us, but especially to our young people. And Father Tolton, the youth can see a true model of faith and even of adventure in the life of this courageous African-American. While we look with sorrow at the bigotry which Father Tolton experienced, even within the church, we can also look at the following facts. Not long after the abolition of slavery in the United States, young Augustus was able to receive a Catholic education. Almost 100 years before the end of official racial segregation in many parts of our country, Augustus was sent to Rome to study for the priesthood at the center of the church's life. Over 60 years before the armed forces were integrated in our country, Father Tolton celebrated his first Mass in St. Peter's Basilica, and returned to the United States as a priest of God. To my awareness, there is no saint that arises out of slavery, emancipation, reconstruction, or civil rights era in this country. Obviously, there are many people who died, people who were murdered, both white and black, through all of that stretch of history. But no one who has been titled or raised up as a saint. If Tolton can succeed in this cause, he would be the first who arises out of the context or the backdrop of the evil of racism. He endured intolerance and hatred for being an African American and a Catholic priest. Let us pray that it might be possible. We need your prayers and support. Thank you.
This lecture was sponsored by the Augustus Tolton Pastoral Ministry Program here at Catholic Theological Union. For those of you who do not know what the Tolton Program is, it's a graduate theological, spiritual, and pastoral formation program for African American lay Catholic men and women, which is co-sponsored also by the Archdiocese of Chicago. And again, I wish to thank the Most Reverend Joseph M. Perry, our Auxiliary Bishop of Vicariate 6, this Vicariate. Thank you again, Bishop, for being with us this evening.